we may be a step closer to the end of the smartphone. And look away now, parents, because this is as close as we'll ever be to a screen without the screen being inside our eyeballs. Meet the Meta RayBan Display glasses. They take all the features of the previous generation Meta smart glasses, open-ear beamforming audio, Meta's baked-in AI assistant, and picture and video recording, and cram in a display overlay to bring a full AR experience. Meta's been working on this hardware design for a while now, and you can see that in everything from the battery placement to the curvature of the open-ear speakers. They're a little chunkier, but from afar, you'd easily mistake these Meta RayBans for RayBan Metas. But there's no mistaking the two when it comes to features. The Meta Display's live caption and translation are jaw-droppingly good, and the digital overlay opens up many more possibilities. Imagine having a repair guide with voice-activated navigation that keeps up with you while you work through a complex repair. But what about replacing the battery in these $800 set of glasses? Or what if the earpiece speaker fails and you need to replace that? Or you get a scratch on the lens and the lens needs to be replaced? The short answer is no, no, and no. None of these things are going to be repairable. But this is bleeding edge tech, and we're fascinated to see how the technology inside works, and to throw down the gauntlet for a more repairable future for wearables in general. So let's jump in and take a look inside. A common design platform has advantages for repair nerds. My experience opening up the last two generations of smart glasses shows exactly how to get into these ones. Starting with some heat on the thinnest section, I can split the two halves of the battery arm with my shiny red limited edition Jerry Rig Everything knife. If you hadn't heard, we teamed up with Jerry Rig Everything to make a 32-bit toolkit that includes this limited edition knife. Pre-order yours now and it'll ship in time for Christmas. The inner cover of the arms are glued in, making removal and replacements a bit of a hassle. And because these glasses are IPX4 rated, anything more than light rain risks damage, so the glue feels like overkill. It's a shame then that Meta didn't decide to use some means of clipping the two halves together to make it easier to access the one consumable component inside, the battery. And that's our next stop in this teardown. There's three press connectors here, going from top to bottom, the last connector is the one for the battery. I'm gonna try my luck and see if I can remove the battery arm. There's a couple of T3 screws in the hinge, neither of which are magnetic, and I can almost release the arm. It looks like I missed a couple of screws though, holding down a strain relief bracket, which I dispatched without much effort. With that, the arm is free. Next, I'm gonna pour a little isopropyl alcohol between the gaps around the battery enclosure. From here, I just need to create enough leverage with my opening pick to lift the battery out. That took a bit more force than I thought it would, and it was a lucky thing that I didn't damage the ribbon cable directly underneath the battery. That ribbon cable leads to a MEMS microphone and an open-ear speaker. The canned battery is rated for 960 milliwatt hours. That's bigger than the 856 milliwatt hours in the Oakley Meta HSTNs we tore down just a month ago. I can desolder the connection point on these speakers using my iFixit portable soldering station, and with the flex cables released, I'll go ahead and apply more isopropyl alcohol around the speaker and lever it out. And with that, the battery arm is done, so let's move over to the processor arm on the other side. It's the same routine again, and Jerry Rig Everything's knife makes another appearance to start us off. Now that the inner frame is removed, I'll take out the hinge screws followed by another strain relief bracket. There's a tricksy cable running right across the mainboard here which needs to be disconnected before I can remove the arm. Peeling it back causes a moment of confusion as a second flex cable enters the mix, but each are detangled and sent on their merry way. That releases the processor arm. I can now wedge another one of my opening picks under the main board and heat it out. The heart of the board houses the Snapdragon AR1, which sits underneath a multi-chip package containing 32GB of flash storage and 2GB of LPDDR4X. That's the same chipset we've seen in other recent Meta smart glasses. Now comes the hard part. The only way I'm going to be able to remove that waveguide and projector intact is by cleanly splitting the frame in half. Easier said than done. I spent a fair bit of time applying heat to the seams, ramping up from 100 degrees Celsius to about 140°C. The glue is strong with this one, and I had to break out the metal pry tool to make any progress. With that, we've very clearly left the non-destructive stage of this teardown well behind us. Any repairs here are going to need specialized skills and specialized tools, two things we want to avoid for DIY repair. With my opening created, I can gently pry the two halves of the frame apart. Let's take a quick look at the camera here. Yes, the camera is in the singular camera. While from the outside it looks like the Meta RayBans have two cameras, one of these is in fact just the external status LED. And now we have arrived at the meat and potatoes of this $800 device, the Waveguide and Projector. This type of assembly is new to me, so I'm taking it one step at a time. First off, I can see a couple of press connectors on the projector, which is also called a light engine. There's very little chance that we're going to be able to disassemble the light engine in one piece, but thanks to Lumafield's Neptune CT scanner, we don't have to. By scrubbing through the outer layers, we can reveal the majority of the tiny lenses that project the red, blue, and green LED light through diffusers. We spoke to augmented reality display and optics expert Carl Gutag to get the lowdown on what makes this technology special. So how is it that these glasses can show a little screen floating in the middle distance? There are two main pieces to the secret. One, there's a little projector in the right arm, what we call the light engine. And number two, the glass is very carefully shaped to bend light. That projector is special, but it's actually a variation that's been around since the 90s. At its heart is a display that works similar to LCD TVs and computer monitors. All of them run on a grid of mirror electrodes that control liquid crystal molecules. When those crystals get hit with an electrical current, they twist and change the polarization of light going through them. Meta's display glasses use a liquid crystal on silicon or LCOS device with a grid of 600 by 600 pixels, bouncing the light from three LEDs off these twisting crystals, then passing them through a series of lenses, mirrors, and a polarizing beam splitter that routes light based on polarization. A lot of manufacturers in the augmented reality space like using LCOS because they're small for a given resolution, they're cheaper than LEDs, and they're very power efficient. We saw the same technology in Google Glass back in 2013 and Magic Leap in 2016 and 2022. But the thing that makes these glasses special is actually an advancement in even older technology. Glassmaking. Inside the glass, a series of partially reflective mirrors bounce some of the light out to your eyes at specific angles. The light first hits these vertical pupil expanders that replicate the light vertically. Next, the light passes through the lens to this series of partially reflective mirrors, which are virtually invisible to the naked eye at most angles. Each of these mirrors reflects approximately 5% of the light that passes through it. This whole system is called a geometric or reflective waveguide. The hard part of it, evidently, is the glass making itself. They stack up layers of coated glass, cut them with a diamond wire saw on the diagonal, and grind them very precisely. It's likely that these waveguides are designed by Lumis and manufactured by the German optics giant Schott, who are apparently the first to attempt high-volume production of geometric waveguides. And it's this specialty glass cutting that sets Meta's AR glasses apart from everything else that we've seen so far. Those other glasses use a system of gratings that bend and split light, instead of the system of mirrors we see inside the Meta display glasses. That old system is called a diffractive waveguide, as opposed to the geometric waveguide we're seeing in the Meta display. The difference accounts for a common problem with AR glasses. When you split light, it doesn't just bend in the direction that you want. This results in eye glow, the way that other AR glasses will flash abstract light shapes at your dinner guests. When you're wearing glasses with that old style of waveguide, you may also see little rainbow artifacts when the gratings catch light from overhead. Meta's specialty glass solves both of these problems by using tiny mirrors, which reflect light instead of splitting it. Someone sitting across from you won't see any evidence of the screen in your glasses, and you won't see any artifacts. The geometric waveguide is a very clean, very effective solution. The only downside is it's an expensive piece of glass. So what do we make of this potentially revolutionary piece of tech? It certainly holds promise, and there's no doubt that every one of the tech giants are betting on wearable AR as the next big product to replace the smartphone. But there are still lots of limitations, from limited battery life to limited processing power to hurdles in the manufacturing process. To add to these concerns, it's very clear that the first iterations of these smart glasses are going to be unrepairable. At nearly $1,000 a pop, many are going to balk at a 3-year upgrade cycle. But there seems to be little doubt that AR tech is maturing and will be arriving in some form or another. For our part, we'll be here to remind manufacturers that advancements in technology must happen concurrently with advancements in repairability.